All right, so now how do you guys feel after listening to that?
Sad.
Yeah,
depressed.
You're all lying if that didn't make you sad in one degree or another. And sadness is normal, so I'm gonna be starting by stating the obvious, that life is hard. And just when you think it's gonna get better, it yanks the rug out from underneath you and times can get worse. Death, losses, disabilities, addictions, failures, disappointments, regrets, and pain slithers into every single person's life in one way or another. And almost every single one of you in the survey said that you've been depressed at one point or another. And me too, but actually, is it technically depression? Actually, David Sack talks about how it's popular to be depressed, and there's more of an increased number of depressed people. But why is that? And he talks about the difference between clinical depression and being addicted to sadness. Well, everyone's sad because life is hard. But I want you to consider if it really is technically depression. In no way, shape, or form am I saying that whatever may have happened to you is undercut by illegitimate terminology. I went through many hellish years myself, but I don't know if I can technically call myself depressed. But because of an intro to psychology course, personal experiences, curiosity, I have also been alert to learn more about this idea. There are many reasons why depression is probably not what you think it is. Today I'm going to change the way that you see depression, sadness, and also show you how they differ. First, the idea of depression is one that's been stripped of its complete significance due to the overuse of the term of everyone throwing around that they're depressed. But is depression really what you think it is? Medicine.net describes depression as an illness that involves the body, mood, and thoughts that affects the way a person eats, sleeps, and feels about him or herself. It goes on to talk about how depression isn't a mood and one person can't just wish it away or wake up and just feel better. It's a state and life molds around it and you just learn to live with it. Depression can be clinical or situational. Situational depression occurs if you lose your job, grieve the death of a loved one, or have your heart broken. Those things can throw you into a state of depression because there's something that just cannot be filled in the void that these things leave. But that state may not last forever because you can find fulfillment and redemption in something else, which doesn't mean that the depression goes away. It just means that it decreases its intensity. But with clinical depressions, it's an extremely harder, difficult, more complex component of life because it's something that will follow you around the rest of your life. You can only decrease it in certain ways, but it's there and will not go away. And depression becomes a lifestyle. When you're stuck in a loop, you can't get out. You just think about the last stage of your life and how great it was and compare it to the one that you have now. And it's a horrible state, but it's one that can be treated. It's only one that can be left if it's treated. Treatment in this culture is generally medications. If you go in somewhere and you say that you're upset, they immediately diagnose you as depressed and they just give you medications. But there are other alternatives that can be applied, like emotional counseling or spiritual fulfillment. But this is the only thing that can really help decrease the state of depression. It can't make it go away. For when one's depressed, it will follow them everywhere. But now I'm going to convince you that being depressed is not the same as being sad. Sadness is normally depicted as a light state of the blues, but is it really? It can be hard and it can be long because sadness is a victim of cause and effect. There's always a reason as to why someone's sad. But sadness can last, but it can be grown out of naturally or with effort. It can be completely resolved. Okay, you may not have cried, but you'd be lying if you weren't sad, at least a little bit during the notebook. And you would also be definitely lying if you didn't feel a little bit stinged of grief whenever you were watching Up. And there was definitely enough room on that stupid little door in the Titanic, which was also just sad, but there was room. There was so much room, which is also sad and annoying, but still. That's a little bit different because sadness is something that can resonate with people. It's something that can be felt with different people who may not feel the degree, but at least they can relate to it. But now I'm going to show you why they're different. It can be easier to be sad than happy, and I get that. Sometimes I don't want to smile, and sometimes when people ask how I am, I say I'm fine, but I'm not because I just don't really want to talk about it. And I'm not depressed. I'm just sad, and I'll get over it. Depression lingers and follows for a lifetime, but it can get easier with time and coping. And sadness can happen frequently, but will not last. Sometimes you don't know why you're always low or why you're always pessimistic, and you can't think of a reason why life is good. You're stuck in a loop and can't figure out how to get how. And sometimes you know exactly the reason why you're in your certain state of emotions. Some people can put themselves into their own loop of depression because it's easier to be sad and happy, and I get that, but some people don't want to be better. They constantly blame and watch sad movies and listen to sad songs, complain and ignore and push people away. They define themselves as depressed just because they're addicted to their sadness. ExploringYourMind.com describes the addiction to sadness resulting from lack of self-esteem and self-love. Moping and self-pity can be a lot easier than fixing it. Complaining can be a lot easier than resolving it. And staying down is a lot easier than standing up. But the toxic cycle just makes it even harder to beat. One of my closest friends a couple years ago was extremely unique. And when I mean unique, you'd see this person. You've never met anybody like him. And he loved being weird, and he never thought anything twice about what people thought of him. Then randomly, he worshipped other people's opinions and began to absolutely loathe himself. He pushed everyone out of his life, including me, and made me feel like I wasn't good enough either to be there to help him. He didn't want to be better. He never took advice. He was always miserable, made me know how miserable he was, and made sure that I felt miserable too. No pills can fix that. No person can fix that. I did everything that I could show him his self-worth and how great of a person he was, but I couldn't help him. Only he could help him. Now he's fine and hasn't had a problem since. He wasn't depressed. He was addicted to feeling sorry for himself, and there's a difference. He was just addicted to feeling sorry because that's the only thing that he felt. Now, it's incredibly important to understand the difference between these two things, because in conclusion, it can completely change the way that they're addressed. Treating sadness with pills is unnecessary, and trying to treat depression with a slight pick-me-up isn't going to help at all. When I played the song Up, even if you had no idea where it came from, you felt something, and it's because sadness is a feeling. Depression is not the same thing, and now you know why. As Alyssa Milano said, accept sadness and pain and depression. Realize that without them, joy and happiness mean nothing and are nothing different.